We have got familiar with the abbreviations used by Raymond Williams in this particular book. Those particular abbreviations are used in the entire book. And you will come across some of these abbreviations in this particular discussion as well. Now here we are talking about culture. While talking about culture, I have tried to divide this particular discussion into three sections. This division is actually given by me, not by Raymond Williams, actually, for your convenience. He discusses culture as a concept, and there are 5 to 6 pages of discussion. But what I have done is just I divided this particular discussion into three parts. One, as culture as concept in Latin. First of all, he talks about the Latin origin of the term, and then he goes on talking about other languages, it's used in other languages, in German, French, etc. And then he talks about three different aspects of culture, three different components of culture. We shall be talking about all these things. Firstly, we shall talk about culture as concept in Latin. Means how it was used in Latin language. So this is the original essay, the original expert from the book, Keywords. As I mentioned earlier, there are 100 such words, and we are going to talk about only one word, that is culture. That is related to our paper. Of course, other words are also related, but we are not going to discuss all those words. But I suggest you people to go through all those words. You will understand how to talk about the cultural origin of these words. Raymond Williams says that culture is one of the 2 or 3 most complicated words in the English language. Okay, he says there are 2 or 3 complicated, most complicated words in the English language, and culture is one of them. Now, how? Why? What is the reason behind it? He talks about the reason. This is so partly because of its intricate historical development. The first reason that he talks about this complication of the word culture is the historical development, its intricate historical development in several European languages. Partly, he says, and mainly because it has now come to be used for important concepts in several distinct intellectual disciplines. So why this term is complicated? Partly because of its historical, intricate historical development. It's complicated historical development in several European languages such as English, German, French, Spanish, etc. And the main reason is that it has now come to be used for important concepts in several distinct, different intellectual disciplines. Culture is used in sociology, culture is used in anthropology, culture is used in language studies. Okay, culture is used in literary criticism. So in different intellectual disciplines, the culture, the concept is in use. Therefore, we think that it is crucial to discuss this particular term. And in several distinct and incompatible systems of thought, in philosophy, etc. Means culture is an important concept in different domains of knowledge. And then he talks about the FW. We are already familiar now. We have become familiar with the abbreviations, but still I have given the meaning of FW into bracket here. The immediate forerunner of this word. In the same or other another language, in English or in another language, is cultura. Okay, that is cultura. It is from Latin. Means culture comes from Latin cultura. And the ultimate traceable word from which its meaning is derived, the root meanings are derived, is Latin colere. Colere is the Latin word, and from this particular word, yes, he goes back to find the roots of this word. And then he says, immediately means now, as soon as you think about the word culture, then we realize that it comes, it derived from Latin cultura. But he goes back beyond that as well. He tried to trace it back, and then he comes to the root, the ultimate traceable word, that is colliery. Okay. Colliery had a range of meanings. When we go back beyond cultura, and when he finally reaches to colliery, so colliery had a range of meanings. Whatever its meanings, inhabit, cultivate, protect, honor with worship. So inhabit means to live. Inhabitation, we say, a place of inhabitation, residence. Okay. So to live at a particular place, that is the meaning of colliery. Or even it means cultivate. These are some of the root meanings of the word. Cultivate, to cultivation, you know, we cultivate grain, etc. Then protect is another meaning of colliery. And eight another meaning is honor, to show respect with worship. Means, for example, towards God. We show respect, honor by worshipping. And what he observes is that some of these meanings eventually separated, finally, gradually, eventually means in the end, they got separated from this word, colliery. Though still with occasional overlapping, and still there is a kind of overlapping in the meanings, in the derived nouns. Means in certain context, there is a kind of overlapping. Means they get mixed up. For example, he says, inhabit, developed through colonus. Colonus is a Latin word to mean colony. We say it's a colony or colonial rule, etc. So inhabit, developed through the word, Latin word colonus. Honor with worship developed through cultus. Okay? Again, it is a Latin word to mean cult. So honor with worship. So this is the kind of overlapping that he talks about. So this is how they got separated eventually, but occasional overlapping is there. Then he comes to the FW. FW is the immediate forerunner of a word. Means when we talk about culture, we go back to cultura. So cultura took on the main meaning of cultivation or tending, not tending animals, etc. Including, means he refers to Cicero. Cicero was the Roman writer. In his reference, we come across cultura animi. Just now I told you, tending animals. Okay. So though with subsidiary medieval meanings of honor and worship, apart from the main meaning of the term cultura, the main meaning of cultura is cultivation or tending. And even in Cicero, we come across Cicero's works, we come across this meaning. He uses the word cultura animi, but there are some other subsidiary meaning, not the main meanings. Subsidiary medieval meanings of honor and worship. Okay, so we can go back to English culture as worship. So we have already referred to the term CF. So it too means you have to refer to. CF stands for refer. Okay, refer English. He refers to English culture as worship, and it was found in Caxton's work in the year 1483. Now, why am I going into the depth of these things? No, I don't want to summarize it. Rather, we have to discuss line by line, because you will get an idea of, the thinking process, how he understands, how he correlates. Raymond William correlates, and you can see the depth of study to understand the scholars, how the scholars become scholar. Then he talks about the French forms of cultura. He refers to culture. This is old French, and this has developed its own specialized meanings. And later it became culture by EC 15. EC 15 means the first period of a century, third century. 15 you can see. Now we too are in the first period of the 21st century. And from then it passed into English. In 15th century, the term culture came to be used from culture. Cultura became culture in old French. Then, during the first period of the third century, it became culture, and from there it passed on into English. So the primary meaning again of the word is husbandry, animal husbandry, is the tending of natural growth. So for example, you talk about, sericulture, animal husbandry, etc. So that is the primary meaning of the French word. And when it came to English, it meant the same, the tending of natural growth. So animals, birds, etc. Or even the crop too was there. So culture in all its early uses was a noun of process, we need to understand. Whether in Latin, in French, or in English, it meant a noun of process. That means the tending of something. Basically, crops or animals. So that is the origin of the term culture. And apart from that, there was subsidiary meanings. The subsidiary coulter. Coulter means ploughly share is the meaning. And had traveled by different linguistic route from culture, Latin, which meant ploughly share, ploughing, then culter in Old English to the variant English spelling culter, coulter, then coulter, and late as what we say the first period of the third century, 17. EC 17, it came to be culture. Okay, he refers to Webster. Then in the book, Duchess of Malfi, we come across the use. Okay, Duchess of Malfi, I feel it is the Elizabethan drama by Marvel. Okay, then heart burning cultures, that is the meaning of the word. Means he uses the word. This word is found in, I'm sorry, Webster's book, Duchess of Malfi. In that book, we come across the use of the term heart cultures as heart burning cultures. So this provided a further basis for the important next stage of meaning. So it became metaphorical. Heart burning cultures. And then from the EC 16, I'm sure that now you know the meaning of EC, the first period of the third century. So EC 16, the tending of natural growth was extended, mean the meaning earlier meaning of tending of natural growth. And this meaning was extended to a process of human development. First of all, it was related to crop and animals. Now it is extended to mean a process of, for example, we talk about a cultural development. So it started to be used in the context of human development. And this alongside the original meaning in husbandry. You see, it has, for example, I told you, we use the term like, you know, in zoology and other such subjects as such as animal husbandry, etc. So the original meaning in husbandry was the main sense that we need to, you are the students of semantics, you have studied the different types of meaning, conceptual meaning and connotative meaning. So the conceptual meaning remained the same, the main sense, until IC 1C18 or the last period of 3rd century and EC 19. Okay, EC 19 is the early period, the first period of that year, 19 of the 3rd century. So this is how we understand the development of the term and its meaning during this period. So now even in Moore, Thomas Moore, you might be knowing. Thomas Moore was a British writer. He is well known for his Utopia. Before Elizabethan period, he was there. And in his work, we come across the reference to the word culture, to the culture and profit of their minds. Now here, culture stands for the development of human mind, for the benefit of human minds. And even we come across the use of this word in Bacon. Bacon was the dramatist of, you know, writer of 17th century, Elizabethan writer. In his work as we come across the culture and manurance of minds. So with the same meaning. In Thomas Hobbes, you must have studied in paper one. Okay, Thomas Hobbes was the philosopher and political thinker. In his work as well, we come across the use of the word, a culture of their minds. So if you refer to all these, even in Johnson's, Samuel Johnson, or not Samuel Johnson, I'm sorry, Ben, maybe Sam, he is referring to Dr. Johnson only. She neglected the culture of her understanding because it is the year is shown here, 1759, that is the what you call neoclassical period. So in all these works, we come across the use of the culture to refer to the human development. So at various points in the development, what we see is two crucial changes occur. Now, what are the changes? First, it was a direct change. And second, an extension of particular processes to a general process. Okay? He refers to the general process which we carry out in our day-to-day life. So it is from the later development, that is general process, that the independent noun culture began its complicated modern history. That's what he says. From the general process, not from the direct. Means he talks about two changes, the direct change and then the extension of particular processes. So this is the latter, the second one, that caused this complication. The complication that the term culture has in modern history. The process of change is very intricate. Intricate means very complicated, not easy to be understood. And there are latencies. Latency means the depth, the deeper meaning. Latencies of meaning are at times so close that it is not possible to give any definite date. That's what he says. It's not possible to give any definite date. So culture as an independent noun is an abstract process or a product of such a process. When we use culture as an independent noun, it stands for an abstract process or the product of such process. Means product means after going through the process, whatever is the outcome, that is called the product. And that is not important. Before IC18, means the last period of the third 18, the year 18 is referring to the last period of the third century, and is not common before MC19. MC stands for middle period of the third century. So it was not so common during that period. But these changes that we are talking about are not so sudden as such. He refers to the use of the term culture in Milton, in the second revised edition of the Ready and Easy Way to Establish a Free Commonwealth, a work by John Milton, which was published in the year 1660. And in this work, we come across the use of the word culture. I quote, "Spread much more knowledge and civility. A religion, though all parts of the land, but communicating the natural heat of government and culture more distributively to all extreme parts, which now lie numb and neglected," unquote. So these are the lines from the work by John Milton. So he refers to the metaphorical meaning of the word natural heat, and it is still in use. Then he refers to civility. Now we talk about civilization. It's still written where these words were there in 19th century. Means up to 19th century, these were the senses. And then we would normally expect culture from 19th century. These words came to mean these things. And even Milton's argument is that Milton is writing about a general social process. Culture stands for a definite stage of development. We say he is a cultured person. She is a cultured girl. So that is a kind of stage of development that we are referring to. Then in C1S stands for, let me tell him. The first century, you can say. England, in the first century, the general process acquired definite class associations. Now, this is very important. We have to understand. Means the term culture got associated with particular class of people. Of course, cultivation and cultivated were more commonly used for this. Okay, but they were not, but there is a later of 1730 by Bishop of Killala to Mr. Clayton. Okay, he refers to this particular letter, and he cites it. This particular work is cited from Plum in this 18th century England, he refers to. And this letter has this clear sense of what we call cultivation and cultivated. So he quotes here, I quote, "It has not been customary for persons of either birth or culture to breed up their children to the church." Now the here culture is associated with class, particular class of people. Okay, then he refers to Akenside with reference to Pleasure of Imagination of 1744. The writer wrote, nor purpose, I quote, nor purpose, state, nor culture can bestow, unquote. Okay, here again the reference is to the class. And then he refers to William Wordsworth, I quote, where grace of culture hath been utterly unknown. Again, you can understand culture is associated with class. It is with reference to his 1805 work, 1805 work. And then John, even in Jane Austen's Emma, there is a reference to the use of the word with this meaning. Every advantage of discipline and culture. So culture stands, is associated with class now. So this is how we understand the development of the word. Culture was developing in English towards some of its modern senses before the decisive effects of a new social and intellectual movement. This is how he talks about the Latin origin of the word culture. In the next lecture, we shall talk about its development in other languages.